Hello everyone. Life is a belief. If we can believe that we can win, we can surely make it happen. I hope everybody is preparing for the exams with that same belief. Let's get into the topic. So today's topic is on disorders of sexual development. Apart from being a very important and also high yielding topic for NEET PG as well as our NSET, it is also easiest topic if you understand the concepts clear. Before going into the disorders, let's see what is a normal sexual development. Gender identity. So how can you say that a particular person is a male or a female? Using three factors: genetic, gonadal and phenotype. Genetic is nothing but the presence of XY genotype or XX genotype. Gonads is the presence of either ovaries or testes. Phenotype is external appearance, presence of a female or a male external genitalia. So now, which determines this gender identity? Here comes the hero of our chapter, SRYG, which is also called as testis determining factor. This SRY gene is present in the distal short arm of chromosome Y, YP11.3, which is an important MCQ. Till 5th week of life, the gonads are bipotential, that is, they can develop into testis or ovary. They have a cortex and a medulla. This is cortex which develops into ovary. This is medulla which develops into testis. So this SRY gene will activate SOX9 gene, which further activates other genes that are responsible for development of testis. Those are fibroblast growth factor 9 gene FGF and steroidogenic factor SF1 gene. This is the MCQ question. This leads to development of testis from the medulla at 7th week of gestation. Now, what are the genes that is responsible for the development of ovary then? Those are WNT4 gene and RSPO1 gene. So these genes will cause the development of ovary from the cortex at 8th week of gestation. So this SOX9 gene will inhibit the expression of WNT4 and RSPO1 gene. So when the genotype is XY, that means presence of Y, which means SRY gene is present, this SRY gene will activate SOX9 and FGF9 gene and inactivates WNT4 and RSPO1 gene and lead to the development of testis. But if the genotype is XX, there is no SRY. So WNT4 and RSPO1 gene will get activated. This will inhibit this SOX9 gene and lead to the development of ovary. Clear? Let's see the genital duct differentiation and development. First, we'll see the duct differentiation and development of external genital organ of male, then female. Here comes, you can see two ducts are present. This is paramesonephric duct, which is also called as Mullerian duct. Medial to the Mullerian duct, you can see an yellow color duct that is called as Wolffian duct or mesonephric duct. These are gonads. Till 8th week of life, an embryo has these two gonads. Later, the Mullerian duct will give rise to female internal genitalia. The Wolffian duct will give rise to male internal genitalia. How this happens? When the genotype is XY, that means there is a presence of SRY gene, right? SRY gene means testis will develop. This testis will have Sertoli cells as well as Leydig cells. So what is the action of Sertoli cells? It will secrete AMH, that is anti-Mullerian hormone. As the name indicates, it's against the Mullerian duct. So it will inhibit the development of Mullerian duct, which leads to regression of the Mullerian duct. Once the Mullerian duct regresses, it forms remnants. So the remnants of Mullerian duct in males is an important MCQ, that is appendix of testis and prostatic utricle. Whereas Leydig cells will secrete testosterone. This is an MCQ. Under the action of beta-HCG till 20 weeks of gestation. After 20 weeks, luteinizing hormone will influence the lady cell to secrete the testosterone. This secretion of testosterone starts at 8th week of life. And it peaks at 15th to 18th week of life. This is also an MCQ question. This will lead to the development of this Wolffian duct. So the Wolffian duct differentiates into vas structures, that is vas deferens, epididymis and seminal vesicles. High local testosterone is needed for the development of this vas structure. High local testosterone. So for the same reason, Wolffian duct do not develop in a female fetus who are exposed to high levels of adrenal androgen. Example, in case of congenital adrenal hyperplasia, or exposed to the maternal androgens. For example, in a case of pregnancy luteum. So next, this testosterone gets converted into dihydrotestosterone with the help of the enzyme 5-alpha reductase, which is an MCQ question. So dihydrotestosterone will lead to the growth of male external genitalia around 10 weeks of gestation. Now we'll see the development of external genitalia in males. Here you can see the external genitalia, which is a bipotential genitalia. That is, till 9 weeks of gestation, the external genitalia will be in the bipotential state. That is, they can develop into either male external genitalia or female external genitalia. Under the influence of this dihydrotestosterone, here you can see the genital ridge, which elongates rapidly, pulling the urethral fold upwards. So this urethral fold, you can see it's elongated and it is surrounded and it is surrounding the urethral groove. So this genital ridge will give rise to glans penis. It is an important MCQ. This urethral fold will fuse with each other around the urethral groove and give rise to penile urethra. So urethral fold give rise to penile urethra. Next is the scrotal swelling, which is also called as labioscrotal swellings or genital swellings. This genital swelling will fuse and they form scrotum. So next MCQ is genital swelling gives rise to scrotum, right? So this, I again repeat, genital ridge gives rise to glans penis, urethral fold give rise to penile urethra, and the genital swelling gives rise to scrotum. So this development of this external genitalia in males completes by 12 to 14 weeks of gestation. So this is an important MCQ. Next, we see the genital duct development in females. So in females, the genotype is XX. That means no SRY genes. So ovary is developed, which develops by 8 to 9 weeks of gestation under the influence of ONT4 and RSPO1 gene. 1 week earlier to testis. So if ovary is a gonad, which means there is no Sertoli cells, there is no Leydig cells. So, which further means there is no AMH, there is no testosterone. When there is no testosterone, what happens to the Wolffian duct? Good, it regresses. The regressed Wolffian duct will leave some remnants in the female internal genitalia. And you can see these are the remnants. Let name the remnants. This is hydatid of Morgagni. You can see the ovary here. Ovary is also called as oophorum. For example, when you take a ovary out, that is called as oophorectomy. So, you can see the remnant here. It is above the ovary. So, it is called as euphophoron. You can see the structure here. It is to the side of the ovary. So, it is parafuron. And this duct-like structure is called Gartner's duct. And since there is no AMH,
there is no anti-Müllerian hormone. So the Müllerian duct will differentiates into fallopian tube, uterus, cervix, and at last upper part of the vagina. Let's see how this differentiation occurs. So here you can see the undifferentiated gonad, Wolffian duct, and the Müllerian duct. So now the gonads are differentiated to ovary, so that Wolffian duct regresses, and you can see the Müllerian duct developing into upper part of the vagina, uterus, and the fallopian tube. The same happens in the opposite side also. Now what happens? This Müllerian duct will crosses the Wolffian duct lateral to medial and to fuse with its counterpart. So after fusion, it will look like this. So this fusion will occur by 12th week of gestation. After fusion, they form a uterine septum, which is later followed by disappearance of the septum in a cephalate pattern. It is a very important MCQ. Cephalate pattern means below upwards. From below to upwards, the disappearance will occur. Now we can see the vagina. The upper part of the vagina, as I already said, it is developed from Müllerian duct, which is mesodermal in origin. Is an important MCQ. Whereas lower part of the vagina will develop from urogenital sinus. This yellow color part is called urogenital sinus, and this urogenital sinus is endodermal in origin. So this is an important MCQ. At last, the canalization of this uterus, cervix, vagina gets completed by 5th month of intrauterine life, that is 20 to 22 weeks of gestation. Now let us see about the development of external genitalia in females. So here you can see that bipotential external genitalia. Now in case of female, it is XX genotype, right? XX genotype means no SRY gene, so there will be development of ovary. So ovary will be secreting estrogen. Under the influence of estrogen, this genital tubercle will lead to the development of clitoris, which is homologous to glans penis in males. As I already said, genital tubercle give rise to glans penis. Here then urethral fold give rise to labius minus, which is homologous to penile urethra in males. This is also important MCQ question. Next is genital swelling. Here you can see the genital swelling, which give rise to labium majus, homologous to scrotum. So these are important MCQ points. Next, apart from this, other two important MCQ points are two more homologous structure. So the first one is prostate, which is homologous to skene glands, which is also called as paraurethral glands. And the second important MCQ is bulbourethral gland or Cowper gland, which is homologous to Bartholin gland in females. Okay, so prostate, then comes the Bartholin glands. Okay, now we are done with the anatomy. Let's see an MCQ to know how much we understood the topic. So during sexual differentiation in males. So it is about sexual differentiation in males. Which of the following is true? Option A. Leydig cell produces Müllerian inhibiting substances. Already I said testis has two type of cells. One is Sertoli cells and other is Leydig cells. Sertoli cells will secrete anti-Müllerian hormone AMH. Whereas Leydig cell will secrete testosterone. Right? So here it's given Leydig cell produces Müllerian inhibiting substance. So this is a wrong option because Leydig cell produces testosterone. Coming to the second option, primitive gonad differentiate into testis due to the presence of SRY gene. Yeah, SRY gene will lead to the development of testis. So here the MCQ point is, what are the genes responsible for testis development? SRY gene, then SOX9 gene, then FGF9, then SF1. This is a MCQ point. Same for ovary development. WNT4 and RSPO1 gene. Right? Okay, coming to the third option. Antigen binding protein is responsible for development of male external genitalia. I already said male external genitalia development is due to dihydrotestosterone. So C option is also wrong. Then coming to D option, Wolffian duct regresses. So in a sexual differentiation in males, Wolffian duct doesn't regress. What happened to the Wolffian duct? Wolffian duct will differentiates. Instead of regression, it differentiates into vas structures. Vas deferens, epididymis and seminal vesicle. Then what regresses? Mullerian duct. So the Mullerian duct will regress in case of male sexual differentiation. Next we go into the disorders of sexual development. Traditionally, this disorder of sexual development is called as hermaphroditism, which is divided into two types, true and pseudo-hermaphroditism. True means there is a presence of both ovary as well as testis. This is called true hermaphroditism. Pseudo means it is different. Example, in case of male pseudo-hermaphroditism, testis will be the gonads, but the external genitalia will be of female. But in case of female pseudohermaphroditism, gonad will be ovary and they will have male external genitalia. But this term hermaphroditism now outdated. Now we are using the term disorders of sexual development. And we divide this into three types. First is 45XX disorder of sexual development. Second one, 46XX disorders of sexual development. And the last one is sex chromosome disorders of sexual development. Sex chromosome disorder means 45, either it is 45X or 45XXY. Let's see the important topics in this disorders of sexual development. Androgen insensitivity syndrome, Swyer syndrome. These androgen insensitivity syndrome and Swyer syndrome, these comes under 45XY disorders of sexual development. Whereas Turner syndrome and Klinefelter syndrome comes under sex chromosome disorders of sexual development. Mullerian agenesis and congenital adrenal hyperplasia comes under 45XXTST. So in this video, we are going to see about the first five topics. We'll deal with this congenital adrenal hyperplasia in another video.
The first topic is androgen insensitivity syndrome. It is the most common cause of male pseudohermaphroditism, MCQ point. And also the most common cause of ambiguous genitalia in males. When you see males, then what is the most common cause of ambiguous genitalia in females? It is congenital adrenal hyperplasia. This androgen insensitivity syndrome is also called as testicular feminization syndrome. So coming to the inheritance, this is actually X-linked recessive. So X-linked recessive means the daughters will be the carriers and the sons will inherit the disease. So coming to the defect, as the name indicates, this is androgen insensitivity syndrome. That means insensitivity to androgen. So the defect here is with the androgen receptors. Let us see the mechanism. Okay. This patients will have a normal male genotype, that is 46XY. So what will be their gonads? Testis. Their testis will be a normal functioning testis, but it is undescended, present either in the inguinal canal or in the abdomen. So this testis will produce a normal amount of testosterone. Normal means normal for a male range. Okay. So already I said testosterone will act on the ducts and lead to the differentiation of the Wolffian duct into vas structures. Vas deferens, epididymis and seminal vesicles. The same testosterone under the influence of 5-alpha reductase enzyme will get converted into dihydrotestosterone and will lead to the formation of male external genitalia. But here the defect is with the androgen receptors. Even though the testosterone and dihydrotestosterone is of normal range, they can't act.
because of defect in the androgen receptors. So what happens? When the testosterone can't act on the receptors, Wolffian duct will regress. At the same time, the testes will produce anti-Mullerian hormone. So what happened to the Mullerian duct in the presence of anti-Mullerian hormone? It also will regress. So the internal genitalia will be none, because no Mullerian duct, no Wolffian duct differentiation. But these patients will have a blind vagina. Why? Because lower part of the vagina develops from urogenital sinus. Good. Let us see about the external genitalia. No dihydrotestosterone, so they can't act on that bipotential external genitalia, which eventually develops into female external genitalia. So coming to the secondary sexual characters, that is breast and pubic and axillary hairs, sexual hairs. This excess testosterone will get converted into estrogen under the influence of the enzyme aromatase. Remember, this is an MCQ. Aromatase will convert the testosterone into estrogen. So what is the action of estrogen? It will act to the breast tissues and lead to a normal breast development. That is Tanner stage 4. But for the development of pubic and axillary hair, we need dihydrotestosterone. Even though dihydrotestosterone is present, it can't act on the receptors. So there is no pubic and axillary hair. So how these patients will present? They present with the complaints of primary amenorrhea. When you examine them, they will have a normal breast development, but no pubic and axillary hairs. So when you do a perivaginal examination, there is no uterus. These patients can also present earlier as a female child with inguinal swelling or a hernia. Because the testis is undescended, it is present either in the inguinal canal or in the abdomen. So they can present as an inguinal swelling or with inguinal hernia. So what is the investigations you will do? So first investigation is testosterone. If you do a testosterone, these patients will have increased testosterone, which is normal for a male. Okay, so karyotype is 46XY. USG, which is the initial diagnosis, which is helps in the initial diagnosis. When you do a USG, there won't be any uterus or fallopian tube, but you can see a undescended testis either in the inguinal region or in the abdomen. How you manage this patient? Most important thing is disclosure of diagnosis, which should be done in the most sensitive manner. First, regarding her menstruation. Second, regarding her fertility issues. See, this patient has a normal testis, but no ovary and no uterus, but brought up as a female child, right? Because of the absence of uterus, she can't menstruate. And also, there is absence of ovary. So, she can't be pregnant. Even she can't be a mother of her own biological child. Coming to gonadectomy, the next step. So, this testis is undescended, which is more prone for development of malignancy. 1 to 3% risk. It is an important MCQ. What malignancy? Gonadoblastoma. So we have to do a gonadectomy, but here MCQ is when, because the excess testosterone gets converted into estrogen under the influence of aromatase enzyme. This estrogen is required for the normal female breast development. So we have to wait till those pubertal changes and we can do this gonadectomy. So when MCQ arises, when you will do the gonadectomy in a patient with androgen insensitivity syndrome, you have to pick up the option after pubertal changes achieved. Okay. Next, once you do a gonadectomy, so your gonadectomy is done. Now, you have to replace this patient with estrogen hormone. One and only estrogen hormone. Okay. She is a female child. So, she is a female. So, she will, if she wishes to marry and she wants to have a normal sexual life, what you have to do. In such cases, you have to advise her regarding vaginoplasty. Vaginoplasty is nothing but this small blind vagina which develops from urogenital sinus. You have to increase the length of that vagina so that she will have a good sexual function. So this vaginoplasty you can do by two methods. One is non-surgical method, the second is surgical method. Always the first line is non-surgical method. Just remember the name, Frank method, second is Ingram method. In this two method, just we use vaginal dilators. By progressive dilatation, we will bring the length of the vagina. If this fails, if the conservative method fails, then you have to go for surgical method. So coming to surgical method, what are the available methods? McIndoe vaginoplasty, William Vulvo vaginoplasty, intestinal neovagina, vegetative procedure and Davido procedure. This first three procedures are outdated. Friends, just remember the names for MCQ point of view. These Vecetti procedure and Davido procedure is very important nowadays because they are the popular methods done today. Here very important MCQ is these two procedures can be done laparoscopically as well as by open procedure. So first we'll see what is Vecetti procedure. This is a pelvis and this is a blind vagina. Here you will give a traction in this retrohymenal space. So the progressive traction will lead to the development of a neovagina. Next, Davido procedure. See this picture. This is bladder. This is the rectum. So here we will dissect in between this retrovesical space, that is space between the bladder and rectum. After dissecting, you will mobilize the peritoneum. Here you can see the yellow color structure, that is peritoneum. You will mobilize the peritoneum, create the vaginal fornices and attach the peritoneum to the introitus. Again, I repeat, dissect the retrovesical space, mobilize the peritoneum, create the vaginal fornices and attach this peritoneum to the introitus. Once this procedure is done, in post-operative period, you will insert a vaginal mold which will keep for 6 weeks, followed by use of regular vaginal dilators. This is till commencement of her regular sexual activity. After the commencement of a regular sexual activity, she can stop using this vaginal dilator. So this is Davido procedure. Next we see about partial androgen insensitivity syndrome. So as the name itself tells you, this is also an androgen insensitivity syndrome. That means the body is insensitive to androgen, defect in the androgen receptor. But here the word is partial. That means the androgen receptors are partly present and the clinical presentation will depend upon the degree of responsiveness of this androgen receptors. So here already the testosterone can act only partial. So the remaining testosterone will get converted to estrogen under the action of aromatase and leads to the breast development, right? Because of the partial action of testosterone, Wolffian duct won't develop. It will regress. So there is, as usual I said, there is no internal genitalia except for a blind vagina. So they present with the primary amenorrhea. Coming to the secondary sexual characters, it will be normal because of the partial action of this testosterone. But what happens to the external genitalia? The external genitalia will be of female, but due to this minimal action of testosterone, there will be signs of virilization. That is, they have clitoromegaly and labial fusion. So we call their external genitalia as ambiguous genitalia. If you see a question which is like you think that it looks like androgen insensitivity syndrome, like primary amenorrhea, normal breast development, no uterus. Sometimes they may give there is no sexual has. Sometimes they might give there is a sparse sexual has. If this case persists, then you check for another keyword, either ambiguous genitalia or clitoromegaly or labial fusion. If this any of these word is given, then you have to go for the option partial androgen insensitivity syndrome. Next is the mildest form of the androgen insensitivity syndrome, Riefenstein syndrome. Here the testosterone action will be not partly, it's little more compared to the partial androgen insensitivity syndrome. So here the external genitalia will be of male. So they are actually males, but they are under-virilized. You might remember the word under-virilized. So the external genitalia will be of males, but the problem here is they will have a bifid scrotum and hypospadiasis. Internal genitalia. So because of the action of testosterone, the Wolffian duct will develop into vas structure, vas deferens, epididymis and seminal vesicle. But the problem is they are poorly developed. And remaining testosterone get converted into estrogen, and there will be a breast development which is normal as for females. So here we call this condition as gynecomastia. So only these patients are more prone for breast cancers. Okay. Next, coming to Swyer syndrome. Swyer syndrome is a pure gonadal dysgenesis. That is, pure gonadal dysgenesis means there is no gonads. So why there is no gonads? Let's see. Genotype is XY. That is a male genotype. XY means there should be SRY gene. This SRY gene should activate the development of testis. But here the problem is there is deletion or mutation of this SRY gene. So testis is not developed. There will be only streak gonads instead of testis. When there is no testis, there is no AMH, there is no testosterone. So friends, remember the anatomy. When there is no testosterone, what happened to the Wolffian duct? Very good. Wolffian duct regresses. Then external genitalia, it will be of female. Then what happened to the secondary sexual characters? Secondary sexual character means breast, pubic and axillary hairs, right? For breast. For the development of breast, we need estrogen, right? Here, there is no source of estrogen. There is no testosterone. At the same time, there is no ovary. So, there is no estrogen. So, no breast development. Coming to the pubic and axillary hair, here our answer is also no, because of the absence of testosterone. Now, the interesting fact is, what is internal genitalia? There is no AMH, that means no anti-Mullerian hormone. So the Mullerian duct will develop into uterus, fallopian tube and upper part of the vagina. Lower part of the vagina develops from urogenital sinus. Okay, so these patients will be brought up as a females because they have a female external genitalia. When you examine them, they won't have any secondary sexual characters. When you do a pelvic examination, they have a normal uterus, normal vagina. But actually their uterus and vagina will be little small in length. Okay. So this is the presentation of Swyer syndrome. So what happens to the investigation? When a patient comes to you, a female patient with primary amenorrhea, on examination, a normal uterus, but there is no secondary sexual characters. So, what investigation you will do? First, you will send the hormone profile. Her estrogen will be low, but her FSH and LH will be high because of the absence of negative feedback mechanism. This is called as hypogonadotrophic hypogonadism. Right? Okay. When you do the karyotype, this gives the diagnosis because she is actually male by her genotype. So, karyotype will be 46XY. Now, how will you treat this patient? So, there is streak gonads, right? So you have to do a gonadectomy. As I already said, whenever you speak about gonadectomy, two important MCQ. One is when you will do. Second is what is the percentage, that is what is the risk of malignancy. What malignancy will happen here? Gonadoblastoma. So, as I said already, in androgen insensitivity syndrome, the risk of malignancy is 1 to 3%. But in case of Swyer syndrome, the risk of malignancy is higher. It's 20 to 30%. So, when you do a gonadectomy means early gonadectomy. Why early? Because in androgen insensitivity syndrome, we wait till pubertal changes. Because excess testosterone is getting converted into estrogen, so we are getting a source of estrogen from that testis. But here the problem is, it is a streak gonads. So there is no source of estrogen. So no need to wait. And also because of the increased risk of malignancy, you have to do a early gonadectomy. Next, hormone replacement therapy. Here you have to replace with two hormones, estrogen and progesterone. Why? This patient has a uterus, a normal uterus. In case if you give only estrogen, because of the unopposed action of estrogen, there will be endometrial proliferation, which leads to endometrial hyperplasia, which further leads to endometrial carcinoma. So to prevent this condition, we are adding progesterone. Okay. Next, fertility issues. As I said already, she is having uterus but no ovary. So how she can conceive? She need oocytes to conceive, right? So she can conceive using donor oocytes. She can get the oocytes from some other person and she can conceive. Second option is adoption. Okay. Now we finished the Swyer syndrome. Next, we see about the most interesting topic, Mayer-Rokitansky-Kusterhauser syndrome, that is MRKH. It is multifactorial genetic syndrome. In some cases, it is autosomal dominant syndrome. Actually, the etiology is not clear, but however, some chromosomal rearrangement and genetic mutations are thought to be responsible for this Mayer-Rokitansky-Kusterhauser syndrome. So, what is the main defect here? Failure of growth of this Mullerian duct. So only this MRKH is also called as Mullerian agenesis. Okay. But here the ovaries are normal. They function normally and they produce a normal amount of estrogen. Okay. There are two types of Mullerian agenesis. One is type 1, one is type 2. Type 1 is typical. Typical means only problem with the Mullerian duct development. Since there is no Mullerian duct, these patients has no uterus, no fallopian tube and no upper part of the vagina. As usual, they have that blind vagina, lower part of the vagina, which develops from urogenital sinus. Okay. So type 2, which is atypical, along with this condition, Mullerian duct abnormality, they will be having other anomalies also, most commonly renal skeletal anomaly, and also they have cardiac anomaly and hearing loss. So this type 2 is also called as Mercus, M-U-R-C-U-S, Mercus. That is Mullerian duct aplasia, renal anomaly, cervicothoracic somite dysplasia. So first, renal anomaly. Here the MCQ is, what is the most common renal anomaly associated with this MRKH? It is renal agenesis. So friends, you can remember this as Mullerian agenesis. So the anomaly associated is also renal agenesis. Second most common is horseshoe kidney. Coming to the skeletal anomaly, the most common is hemivertebra. So how this patient presents? So they have a normal ovary, but there is no uterus. So they present with primary amenorrhea. This is the second most common cause of primary amenorrhea after gonadal dysgenesis. Okay. So the initial investigation of choice is ultrasound. And the gold standard investigation is MRI. To differentiate this MRKH from other conditions, we will use endocrine profile and karyotype. If you do a karyotype, she is a normal female. So she have 46XX genotype. Coming to the endocrine profile, her estrogen, FSH, LH, everything will be normal. Now, what are the other investigations you will do? You know, once you diagnose that it is a case of MRKH, you have to rule out the associated anomalies. Renal USG and intravenous pyelography to rule out renal anomalies. Spine and limb X-rays to rule out skeletal anomalies. Echo to rule out the cardiac anomaly and audiometry to rule out hearing loss. Okay. Now let us see the management of this MRKH. Fertility, which is an important issue. It is opposite of Swyer syndrome. Here she has the normal ovary but there is no uterus. So now she can use this oocytes in this ovary and she can become pregnant of her own biological child using surrogacy. Second option is adoption. So vaginal plasty, it is same as what I explained in complete androgen insensitivity syndrome. Same, we will use this Davido method, Vecchetti procedure methods, and these things you revise as same in the complete androgen insensitivity syndrome. Here important MCQ for vaginoplasty is, what is the length of new vagina you should achieve with these procedure? Answer is 7 to 8 centimeter. This is a very, very important MCQ. Okay. Now, hormone replacement therapy. In androgen insensitivity syndrome and Swyer syndrome, we are discussing about the hormone replacement. Is there any need of such hormone replacement in MRKH? Answer is no. Because the patient has a normal ovary which is secreting normal amount of estrogen. So, there is no need to replace it. Okay. The most important ED of MRKH is androgen insensitivity syndrome. Because these two patients share a same profile. Both are brought up as a females because of female external genitalia. Complaints of primary amenorrhea. And both of them won't have a uterus, fallopian tube and upper part of the vagina. And they will present you with a blind vagina. Okay. So how will you differentiate them? First is the clinical features. Pubic and axillary hair. In androgen insensitivity syndrome, there is a problem with androgen receptors. So there is no development of sexual hair. Whereas in case of MRKH, they are actually normal females except for the problem in Mullerian duct development. So they have a normal amount of pubic and axillary hair. If you do a karyotype, it is 46XY in AIS. It is 46XX in MRKH. Next, testosterone. Testosterone is present in both the cases, but it is of normal for a male range in AIS, normal for a female range in MRKH. Let's see some MCQ, friends. Okay. 16-year-old female, she presents with primary amenorrhea and also with a bilateral inguinal hernia. She has a normal sexual development without any pubic hair. USG shows no uterus, ovaries and vagina. What is the diagnosis? Options are Turner syndrome, Mullerian agenesis, gonadal dysgenesis, androgen insensitivity syndrome. Here, the key points are, first key point is female. Second key point, primary amenorrhea. Third key point, no uterus. When you see these combination of words, female, primary amenorrhea, no uterus, then just think of two diagnoses. Androgen insensitivity syndrome, Mullerian agenesis. How will differentiate this? Search for other keyword, pubic hairs. When there is no pubic hair, then it means its answer is androgen insensitivity syndrome. Okay. A slight modification of the same question. A young female presented to you with complaints of primary amenorrhea. First keyword, female, primary amenorrhea. Second keyword, Examination reveals a normal breast development with absent axillary hair. Another keyword. Pelvic examination shows a blind vagina. Fourth keyword. With clitoromegaly. On USG, gonads are visible in the inguinal region. What is the most likely diagnosis? So options are complete androgen insensitivity syndrome, partial androgen insensitivity syndrome, MRKH, gonadal dysgenesis. With this keyword, female primary amenorrhea, blind vagina, it is either androgen insensitivity syndrome or MRKH. Absent axillary hair tells the answer is androgen insensitivity syndrome. But here there are two options, whether it is complete or partial. In such case, search for the fourth keyword, clitoromegaly, that is ambiguous genitalia. So what is the answer here? Partial androgen insensitivity syndrome. Good. Let's go to the other topic, Turner syndrome. In Turner syndrome, the defect is karyotype, that is 45XO. Loss of a part or all chromosomes, that is 45XO. This is a classical pattern. But in more than 50% of the cases, it is of mosaic pattern. That is 45X with 46XX or 45X with 46XY. Why you have to look for this mosaic pattern? Because you have to find out whether that particular Turner syndrome patient has a Y genetic material or not. Presence of Y genetic material means risk of developing gonadoblastoma. So you have to do gonadectomy. Right? Okay. Let us see the clinical features of this Turner syndrome. The most important clinical feature is short stature, because this short stature is present in all types of Turner syndrome, whether it is a classical pattern or it is a mosaic pattern. The one and only abnormality present in all type of Turner syndrome patient is short stature. The reason for the short stature is because of the mutation or deletion of this particular gene, SOX gene, short stature homeobox containing gene. The other clinical features are low posterior hairline, webbing of neck, broadly and widely spaced nipples, associated with endocrine abnormalities like diabetes mellitus, hypothyroidism, ocular abnormalities, hearing loss, cardiac anomaly. The most common cardiac anomaly is bicuspid aortic wall. A very important MCQ, it's bicuspid aortic wall. Other cardiac anomalies are coarctation of aorta, aortic root dilatation. Then cubitus valgus. Cubitus valgus means increased carrying angle at the elbow. Next is renal anomaly. The most common renal anomaly is horseshoe kidney. Here friends, remember, the most common renal anomaly in Mullerian dysgenesis is renal agenesis. But in case of Turner syndrome, it is horseshoe kidney. And other is osteoporosis. This patients, because of the karyotype 45XO, they have streak ovaries. But their uterus is normal. So they present with amenorrhea and infertility issues. Let's come to the diagnosis. So very important for diagnosis is karyotype. Karyotype gives you the clinching diagnosis. So here the karyotype is 45XO. If you find a patient with a chromosomal fragment of uncertain significance or she has evidence of virilization, then you have to use FISH to see the Y genetic material so that you can do gonadectomy earlier. Okay, how will manage this patient with a Turner syndrome? So the most important feature is their short stature. So you have to give a growth hormone replacement at 4 to 6 years of life to attain a normal height for such patients. Then this patient has a normal uterus but no ovaries. So you have to induce the puberty in them with hormone replacement therapy. How will you induce? First, you will give the estrogen, which will start by 11 to 12 years of life at a dose of 1/8 of adult dose. Then you will increase the dose progressively over 2 to 3 years. to a normal adult dose. Then the patient will get withdrawal bleeding. Once she attains a withdrawal bleeding, then you can add progesterone. After this stage, you can give the patient OC pills or estrogen with progesterone, other combination of estrogen and progesterone, so that she will have her menses every month. Next, fertility issue. So uterus is there, but there is no ovary. So coming to the fertility, here she can conceive using the donor oocyte, or the second option is adoption. But the MCQ point here, very important MCQ point here, is 4 to 8% of Turner syndrome patients can conceive spontaneously, but this decreases with age. Okay, other investigations. So they are associated with other anomalies, right? So you have to do other investigations to rule out this anomaly once you diagnose a Turner syndrome patient. Echo and ECG for cardiac anomalies. They are more prone for hypertension, so you have to do a blood pressure measurement to rule out the hypertension. Audiometry, ophthalmic evaluation, HbA1c and lipid profile to rule out other endocrine abnormalities. Next is 46XX pure gonadal dysgenesis. Here the karyotype is 46XX. So as the name indicates, it's a pure gonadal dysgenesis. So the patients will have streak ovary. So important thing here is, for MCQ point of view, this is how we will differentiate this from Turner syndrome, by using the two features. One is they will have a normal height, unlike Turner syndrome where the patient will have a short stature. Second is no associated anomalies. Just remember these two points alone for MCQ. Next, coming to our last topic, Klinefelter syndrome. It is the most common congenital cause of hypogonadism in males. Here the problem is primary testicular failure. Karyotype of this patient is 47XXY. Let's see why this primary testicular failure occurs. Because of this extra X chromosome, there is a damage to Sertoli cells and Leydig cells. So the testes will be small and firm. They can't secrete a normal testosterone. Because of the absence of testosterone, there is a problem in the skeletal growth. So they will have a long arms and legs. Since there is no testosterone, there is an absence of negative feedback mechanism, which will increase this FSH and LH. Increased amount of LH will activate the few Leydig cells present in the testis and lead to the formation of androstenedione, which gets converted into estrogen. So these Klinefelter patients will have gynecomastia. So coming to the external genitalia, they will have a normal male external genitalia. Fertility issues. Since there is a damage to the seminiferous tubules, these patients will have oligospermia or azoospermia. So they present with complaints of infertility. They can achieve the fertility by using method ICSI, intracytoplasmic sperm injection, by surgically retrieving the sperm from the testis. They are associated with some psychosocial abnormality. This is an MCQ. Lack of insight, poor judgment, and they lack attention span. Next, these patients have an increased risk of breast cancer, mediastinal malignancies, pulmonary diseases, varicose vein, and SLD. So how we'll treat the patient? As I said, it is a primary testicular failure. So problem here is no testosterone. So treatment is replacement with testosterone. Okay. How we'll diagnose the patients, very important for diagnosis is their karyotype, which is 47XXY, which is so peculiar. Then if you do a hormone profile, they have a very less amount of testosterone. So because of the absence of negative feedback mechanism, increased FSH and LH. Here we complete the topic. So a quick revision. So whenever you see a question, when you see the patient presenting with primary amenorrhea, check for the second keyword, uterus. When there is no uterus, only 2DD, androgen insensitive syndrome, MRKH. So search for the third keyword, pubic and axillary hair. If it is absent, then it is androgen insensitive syndrome. If it is present, then it is MRKH. If the keyword gives uterus is present, then you have to think of our other two differential diagnoses. One is Swyer syndrome and other is Turner syndrome. Turner syndrome has a peculiar features like short stature and associated anomalies. Also, they can be differentiated using their karyotype. 46XY in Swyer syndrome, 45XO in case of Turner syndrome.
So next we see the question. So the question here is, in which of the following conditions do the ovary function normally? So here they are asking about the normal ovaries, that is normally functioning ovaries. So option A is Turner syndrome. So in case of Turner syndrome, we discussed that here the chromosome is 45XO. That means they have streak ovaries. Since coming to the second option, MRKH syndrome. In MRKH syndrome, as I already said, the problem is only with the Mullerian duct. Here, the ovaries are exactly normal. These normal ovaries will be producing normal amount of estrogen. So, MRKH is normally functioning ovary. But in case of androgen insensitivity syndrome, problem is they have testis. And in Swyer syndrome, the genotype is XX and they have a streak gonad due to the mutation of SRY genes. So they have streak gonads. So the answer here is the condition having formally functioning ovary is MRKH syndrome. Next we see the other question. Your mother brought her 19-year-old daughter. First keyword. With complaints of primary amenorrhea. Second keyword, general examination reveals a normally developed breast with a pubic hair. On pelvic examination, vaginal ending is blind and uterus is not palpable. Which of the following you suspect? So option here are Mullerian agenesis, Asherman syndrome, gonadal dysgenesis, Turner syndrome. So now let us see about the keywords. First is daughter. Primary amenorrhea, uterus not palpable. That means either it will be AIS or MRKH. When you search for the other keyword, that is presence of pubic hair. So the diagnosis here is MRKH. So the answer is Mullerian agenesis. So students, though the disorders of sexual development seems to be a very tough topic when you are discussing the MCQs, it's actually an easy and very easy topic if you understand the concepts clearly. So see the video twice or thrice to understand the concepts clearly, then you practice the MCQs in disorders of sexual development. So students, if you have a strong belief and put a sincere hard work, surely you will win. So please keep on studying. Don't deviate yourself. Thank you once again. Let us meet in the next video with another interesting topic. Thank you.